How many of you have heard of a reading meditation technique called Lectio Divina? Okay, so if you, in Latin it means divine reading. And what it is basically taking scripture and you read it a few times, you ask God what he wants to tell you through that by pointing out either a word or a verse, and then asking him why that's important and what you should do with it. Well, on Wednesday night in youth group, we did Lectio Divina and we used Psalm 119. And we read about 20 different verses through 119. But the ones that stood out for me, and we were talking about freedom, and that's freedom in Christ, was our topic. But verse 40.
Well, be nice to Levon Froyland today. It's her 90th birthday. Good for you, Levon. Five ships were sitting at anchor near a South Pacific island, and a big storm began to approach, and they could tell it was a humdinger. And so four of them just made sure the anchors were set well, and the fifth one sailed out into the ocean, sailed into the storm, set their path straight into the wind. For 2 days, that ship was beaten and battered. It had everything tightened down, but anything that was loose was lost. And the ship seemed so tiny in the great Pacific Ocean. But after 2 days, the storm wore itself out, and the ship was fine. And then it sailed back and found that the other four ships had all been thrown up onto the beach and left helplessly there. Sometimes we just need to face it, don't we? Sometimes we need to move into it. And that captain understood. And today we're looking at a scripture that shows us how God wants to take us through storms, how he wants to lead us through those things. I heard Pastor Adrian Rogers talk about this passage 50 years ago. Some of you probably hear him on the radio, Christian radio. I was a student at Bethel when he came and spoke, and I still remember that time. In fact, my grandson, Caden, is graduating from that same college this month. I'm really proud of him. Thank the Lord he's still working. But here's the situation. Jacob took his 12 sons and their wives and children and moved to Egypt. There were about 70 people, just a big family. And his son Joseph was already there, and there was a big famine going on. And so in order to have food and a place where they could survive, they moved to Egypt. It was God's will for them. And they ended up staying there for hundreds of years. It was God's plan that they would be in this culture, this great Egyptian culture, in order for them to become a nation on their own. He made sure that they didn't blend in, that they didn't intermarry, they didn't just become Egyptian, but he wanted them to have that experience. And so there they were. But after a period of time, God said, now it's time for you to leave. And he didn't send them out, he led them out, and he showed them the way that they would go. Now that wasn't easy because the Egyptians had made them slaves. The Israelites were not free to come and go. They had to work at menial tasks for the Egyptians, and they were under whip when they didn't provide work hard enough. It was a tough deal. God sent Moses and told Pharaoh, these are not your people, these are my people, and you must let them go. And Pharaoh resisted. 10 different plagues came down on Egypt, darkness and locusts and frogs and different things. And finally, Pharaoh agreed that they could leave. And so God led them out, and he said, I'll give you a clear way to know how to follow my plan. He sent a cloud. It's called a pillar of cloud, just this tall cloud. And they would just see it, and if it was moving, they moved in that direction. At night, it lit up. I don't know if it was lightning in there or static electricity or what, but that thing lit up at night. And so they always knew God is with us. He's right here with us. And if we go wherever he's going, we'll be with him. And so there they were, moving out of Egypt. No more slave masters. A promised land waiting for them. God right there with them to handle any problems or any enemies. The Egyptians even handed them valuable gifts as they left Egypt. I mean, silver and gold and fine clothes and other things. They just were handed to these people as they marched out. And so with everything going their way, they were shocked when they found out that there were going to be obstacles. There were going to be opposition. They did not expect the road to the promised land to have potholes in it. They did not expect to find enemies waiting in ambush to harm them. Maybe they thought the devil would stay behind in Egypt and they wouldn't have any more trouble. But it wasn't that way. And they had suffered a great deal as slaves at the hand of others. And now they needed to realize that they had sins of their own. They had sins in their own hearts. You know, sometimes when we're in pain, when we're hurt, when we're suffering, sometimes we can be pretty focused on ourselves. And God wants us to realize that anything that makes us more self-centered is not his plan. He wanted them to see that they had become selfish and negative and difficult without really realizing it. And so his plan was that he was going to deliver them from sinfulness as well as slavery. He knew their hearts. We need to be delivered from things that oppress us from the outside and from things that corrupt us on the inside. And God wants to do both in our lives. The road to the promised land introduced the people of Israel to a great number of lessons about yielding to God's plan and trusting in his goodness. They had problems. Not every problem comes from God. He doesn't sit around thinking of things to do to us. He's looking for things to do for us. But he knows we have enemies. There is a devil. And he isn't living in Egypt. He's there too. But he's got all kinds of an army that makes a mess for everybody. We've got people in our lives that sometimes just are hurtful. And God says to us, I'm going to allow some of that to happen. Now, there's limits, but I'm going to allow some of it to happen. It has to go past me to get to you. It's Father filtered. But when I let it go back past me, I'm going to attach a lesson to it so that you will get to know me better. I'm going to attach a potential blessing that if you'll receive it the way it's meant to be received, it'll become a blessing in your life. It'll do you some kind of good, and it'll be worth it when you see it. Because every problem has a purpose. Every problem. Something happens to me, and I think, well, that was unexpected. And God says, no, that was selected. That was for you. The first thing that happened is God did not take them on the express route to the promised land. You know, when we were in Israel a few years ago, Lita and I, you could be in Jerusalem and you could arrange to take a trip to Egypt for one day. It's only a couple hour drive. You could get on a bus, you could drive from Jerusalem down to Cairo, you could see the pyramids and this big museum for King Tut and other things, and you could come back to your same motel that night. It isn't a long, long ways. It's closer than Chicago. It's probably closer than Des Moines. I don't remember. But anyway, for them walking on foot, having all kinds of people, all kinds of ages, having animals, it was going to take a while. But it wasn't like going around the world. And if they went along the coast of the Mediterranean, the land would be fairly manageable, and it would be the shortest route. And God said, no, I can't send you that way. Here's what he said. When Pharaoh finally let the people go, God did not lead them along the main road that runs through Philistine territory, even though that was the shortest route to the promised land. God said, if the people are faced with battle, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led them in a roundabout way through the wilderness to the Red Sea. You didn't know they had roundabouts in the Bible, did you? Yeah, not so new. God knew that these people, after all these years of slavery, and these people being people like you and me, valued security more than liberty. They didn't want to fight with the Philistines. The Philistines were an advanced culture. They had an army. They were well developed as a people, and they weren't going to welcome a few million people walking into their land. Some countries might let just anybody walk in, but they weren't going to. And so they would resist. Well, God was leading them. They were going to have God's protection, but they didn't want to trust that. They weren't willing. God knew they will go back to Egypt. Those little brats. They're out of Egypt, but Egypt is not out of them. And so he said, I'm not going to take you that way because I already know you'll fail the test. I'm going to take you on a detour. And you're going to get to where you're going. It'll just be a little longer and a little harder. But if we trust God, we'll find out he's faithful. Musa was a man living in Sudan. He lived there. He grew up there. He was a citizen there. And a lot of people there are not Christians, mostly Muslim. And he gave his heart to Jesus. He went back to his home village to talk to people about Jesus. And the village leaders took him aside and said, no more of that talk. We don't want that here. And one of them said, look, if you just stop talking about it, we'll give you a bicycle. Well, that'd be like giving somebody a car in our culture. It was not a bad thing. He said, no, I can't do that. I love Jesus. I need to talk about Jesus. I'm going to talk about Jesus. So they let him leave, but they hired someone to kill him. They said, now look, you have to make it look, you can't let anybody know who did it or why it was done. Just, it's got to be done secretly. It's got to be done without people knowing it's happening. And so this assassin decided he would just follow Musa around for 2 days and just see where he went and what he did and make his plan. Well, while he was following him around, he was hearing what he was saying and how he was talking to people and what he was sharing. And this man gave his heart to Jesus. And he went back to the village elders and he said, look, here's your money. I can't kill him. I believe what he believes. And now Musa was safe. Not only did the man not kill him, but the elders knew if something does happen to him, it'll come back to us. And so here he was, free to do God's will. But it started when he trusted God. And when we follow Jesus, he's responsible for our safety. He's responsible for our finances and for our health. When we give ourselves to him, we put him in charge. And he's an expert at every area of your life. Your health, your finances, your friendships. He's an expert. I'm not saying he'll make it easy. I'm saying he'll make it happen according to his will. George Mueller understood that. George Mueller lived 100 years ago. He took care of orphans. He started out with just a few. He had a house. And he had a dozen or so orphans living there. One day they got up, they came to the breakfast table as always, and George knew there's no food. He didn't burden them with that. He just said, yeah, come on, sit down. He said a prayer and thanked God for taking care of them. And then he waited, and the door, someone knocked on the door. He said, my bakery just couldn't sell anything. yesterday. I've got all this old bread. Can you use it? George said, yeah, come on in. We'll make toast. And so the guy brought it in. The kids sat down. They were starting to pass it around, and someone knocked on the door. It was the milkman. He said, my milk cart broke its wheel right in front of your house. I don't want the milk to go sour. Can you use it? Well, I guess we could. And so they brought it in, and God did things like that for George Mueller for his whole life, 50 years. And he ended up with up to 2,000 orphans at a time that he took care of. He never asked anyone for money. He just prayed. Well, people knew he needed money, but he never went to them and said, well, we're really low right now. No, he never did. That was just what he felt God wanted him to do, so that not only would he take care of orphans, he would be a witness to how God answers prayer. And he did. And so here's something George Mueller said. The only way to learn strong faith is to endure great trials. Oh, Lord, give me a great faith. Okay, I'm going to give you a great headache. I'm going to give you great things to worry about. I'm going to give you great needs. I'm going to put you in a situation where you need me. He's not being mean. He's not playing with us. He's not saying, oh, you want to play that game, huh? He's not doing that. He's a father. And he says, I will teach you faith, but you only have faith when you don't have something else. You don't have to believe in God's power to pay your mortgage if you've got twice that amount in the bank right now. But when you're broke and you don't know how you're going to pay it, then you'll have faith. Then you'll need faith at least. And when you trust me, you'll see what I can do. And so George had learned that over and over. And he does that for you and me. He will lead us. He led Israel as they left Egypt. He directed their path. He put that cloud for them to follow. And he said this to Moses, tell the people of Israel to turn back and camp across from Pi Hahiroth near Baal Zephon between Migdol and the Red Sea. Now, I don't know that he gave Moses a spelling test on those names, but we know where those two mountains are. Those first two names are mountains. And we can determine where those are. And here's what happened. They walked along until they got to the edge of the Red Sea, and there's just water in front of them. Well, we're not going that way. Over here is this tall mountain. Over here is this tall, rugged mountain. They've got flocks of sheep. They've got little kids. They've got old people. They're not going up either side. Behind them is where they came from. And God said, here's where I want you to park. Just stay right here. Well, in the meantime, Pharaoh decided, what a mistake I made. I shouldn't have let them go. I'm bringing them back. I'm going to punish them for defying me in the first place. And so he led his troops to track them down. He sent out scouts, I suppose, and they came back and said, you wouldn't believe it. Those dumb people, they parked by the sea with a mountain on each side, and we're coming from the only remaining direction. Those people have no military sense. You think God's got military sense? Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds. What have we done letting all those Israelite slaves get away? They asked. The Egyptians chased after them with Pharaoh's army, all his horses and chariots, his charioteers and his troops. The Egyptians caught up with the people of Israel as they were camped beside the shore near Pi Hahiroth, across from Baal Zephon. The exact location God told them to be is where they were. And Pharaoh is gloating at how ridiculous they are and how he's going to make them pay. And when the people realize that dust cloud is being made by chariots and there's Pharaoh's army coming after us, they panicked. They were afraid. They realized we can't go anywhere. We don't want to go towards them, and we can't go anywhere else. And they thought, we're on a dead end. We're in a box canyon. This is it. Well, they were right. It was a dead end for Pharaoh. It was the end of the line for him. It was a trap for Pharaoh. They were the bait. When the Egyptians arrived, the Israelites were terrified. They turned on Moses. They were ready to surrender. Moses made this announcement. Don't be afraid. Stand still and see what the Lord will do to save you today. You will never see these Egyptians again. The Lord is fighting for you. So God slowed down the Egyptians. He actually put a barrier so that they couldn't get to the Israelites right away. And he sent a wind, and it blew, and it somehow opened up the Red Sea so that the water stood up on both sides. It had to be a pretty wide path. I mean, there were 600,000 men, plus their wives, their children, their parents, their flocks, their herds. I mean, 2 million or more people had to cross. You can imagine how wide that lane would have to be. And God sent that wind, and by morning it was dry, and they went across. And then he allowed the Egyptians the freedom to move forward. And they saw the people crossing the Red Sea, and they began to pursue. It was a miracle. A young man, a college student, gave his heart to Jesus, and he was just hungry to know what was in the Bible. He was sitting out on a bench in the college yard there reading, and all of a sudden he says, "Hallelujah!" And one of the professors was going by, one of these kings that Pastor Mike talked about, somebody who thought he knew everything. And he said, what are you saying? He said, "Well, I just read how God opened up the Red Sea for all the Israelites to go through." And he said, "Oh, don't be silly." He said, "It wasn't the Red Sea, it was the Reed Sea. The Reed Sea is just a big marsh. It's not any deeper than, it's no more than knee deep." The guy said, "Really? Huh." And the man started to walk away, and he heard, "Hallelujah." He turned around, "Well, now what? I just read how Pharaoh's whole army was drowned in 2 feet of water." I mean, it's one way or the other, folks. But God did a miracle for them. He took care of them, and he helped them because they needed him. The water returned and covered the chariots, the drivers, and all the Egyptian army that had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not one of them was left. Pharaoh was completely defeated. Of course, the Egyptians didn't write that down. They only wrote down what the things they thought were good, even if they had to make some up. But there is an inscription about a king in Egypt who died, a pharaoh who died in battle. And there's a suspicion maybe this is the one. But they were gone. Here's what happened. The Israelites were out of Egypt, and they never again were going to have to look over their shoulder. They never again were going to be checking the rearview mirror to see if Pharaoh was after them again. It wasn't going to happen. It was done. They were free. It was over. That chapter would never be back. God had taken care of them. And what happened is when Pharaoh's military went down into the seabed to chase them, the wheels started falling off their chariots. What happened to our support staff? What's these mechanics been doing? No, God made the wheels fall off. He caused confusion and panic, and the people, these army members were just, couldn't figure out what was going on and what to do. And some of them wanted to turn back, but before anything could happen, while they're all down in this seabed, the wall of water collapsed, and they were gone. And the Israelites stood on the opposite shore and saw that, and they said, "Wow. We couldn't make that happen, but God did. God did." God could have had them camped somewhere else where they could run for it. God could have knocked off the chariot wheels back in Egypt. God could have caused panic and confusion lots of ways between Egypt and where they were. God could have turned them back. God could have sent down lightning bolts and destroyed them anywhere on the road. God set up this whole situation to happen in exactly the way it did, the dramatic way it did, because he wanted the people of Israel to see something about him. He wasn't having a good time when they were panicky and afraid and angry and upset, and he didn't enjoy what they were going through. It wasn't like that, and he wasn't indifferent to it. He just said, you know what, it's worth it. This is something you need to have happen. This is an experience you need to have, because this is going to change your life. This is going to give you a perspective you would never otherwise have. What God did and the way he did it set up a situation that would have the result that he desired. And here's a little glimpse of it. When the people of Israel saw the mighty power that the Lord had unleashed against the Egyptians, they were filled with awe. Filled with awe before him, they put their faith in the Lord and in his servant Moses. They already had all kinds of emotions going on, and all of a sudden it all transformed into worship. Wow, God, you are something. You are something. You are someone I can trust. If you can do what you just did, you can do anything. If you can settle this problem in my life, you can fix any of them. If I can trust you today, I can always trust you. And God is still calling on us to trust him, to turn to him, to let him have his way. A poster I saw this week said, if it doesn't challenge you, it won't change you. I like God to give me just little samples of what he can do comfortably. I can just kind of take them in while I'm having a bowl of ice cream, reading a good book or watching a good show. Yeah, God, that's good. Thanks, Lord, that's good. No, he wants my undivided attention. He wants to profoundly shape me into the man he made me to be. And there will be times when I will know I need him. I will know I am in trouble unless he steps up. I will know there is no answer unless it's from him. He allows things to come within limits, but they're always intended to draw me to him. And when these people were between two mountains and the deep blue sea, they knew they needed God. They cried out to him. They listened to the instructions he gave, and they saw the answer. It happened 3,500 or so years ago. And every single spring since that day, the Jews have celebrated Passover. They have remembered what happened in Egypt with the 10 plagues. They have remembered marching out to the Red Sea and having it open before them. They have remembered that their enemies were disarmed and removed from any future ill in their life. Every year, this spring, every year. Sometimes Christians observe it. It comes at the same time of the year as Easter. And so we always know it's Passover Easter season. But this is something God told them to do. He said, I want you to remember this. Don't forget what happened. Make sure your kids know. Make sure they have some history so they know how to interpret what's happening in their time. Make sure you don't forget the goodness and the power of God in every generation. A gal named Mrs. Charles Cohen, she had her own name, but she liked to use her husband's name when she wrote, and she wrote a book that's called Streams in the Desert, and it's a devotional book, and she has this to say on one of the pages. Difficulty is the very atmosphere of miracle. It's miracle in its first stage. You ever think that way? Oh man, I broke my arm. Oh, here's a miracle in its first stage. My car won't start? Well, it's the first stage of a miracle. I don't think that way. She says if it's going to be a really great miracle, you're going to really remember, let's start with an impossibility. This can't happen. Okay, God. But you see what she's saying? She's saying live with anticipation. Trust God before you know how he's going to fix it, before you know what he's going to do, before you see how it's going to unfold, say, God, I thank you. You're in charge here. You're in charge. You're capable. I can trust you. And he tells us all we can do that. It says in the Psalms, call on me when you are in trouble, and I will rescue you, and you will give me glory. There are times worship just bubbles out of us. It just flows because we've seen the goodness of God. We've seen the power of God. We've seen the timeliness of God. We've seen how much he cares. And it just, all we can do is worship. It happened with these folks. After such a dramatic deliverance, how in the world? They were dancing, they were singing. Chapter 15 of Exodus is all about it. How in the world would they ever doubt God again? How in the world would they ever forget how he came through and how he can come through? When would they ever question him again? This was going to last, wasn't it? And it did. 3 days. 3 days. When Moses led Israel away from the Red Sea, they traveled in the desert for 3 days without finding any water. When they came to an oasis, the water was too bitter to drink. It's poisonous. So they called the place Marah. The Hebrew word Marah means bitter. The name Mary comes from Marah. Then the people grumbled and turned against Moses. What are we supposed to drink? They demanded. Just took 3 days for them to go from their spectacular and permanent delivery from slavery to go back to griping. Now, they didn't make anything up. This was a serious thing. I mean, they were in Arizona. It was 110 degrees. Well, like Arizona. I've been there when it was 100 or more in Israel. I remember the day we went up to Masada and spent a couple hours. We didn't even, I was with my dad. I was 31 years old. I was just this young guy. We went up there. We looked around and came back down on a trolley car. Oh, I still remember how thirsty I was. I went into the bus. We had a bus group, 48 of us. I had a 2-liter bottle of water in there I had bought. And it sat on the bus all day. It was probably 100 degrees. And I was just guzzling it. You get thirsty when it's hot. You get thirsty when it's dry. You get thirsty after 3 days. You get faint. You've got little kids. You've got flocks and they're young. You've got old folks. They have to have water. We're made for that. We have to have it. We need to drink a lot of water. Most of us don't drink enough, they tell us. This was a legitimate need. It was not a legitimate response to a father who's been caring for them, who got them out of Egypt with the power of his might, who humbled Pharaoh and then destroyed him and his army when he still wouldn't give in. This is God they're talking about. What are we supposed to drink? Who are you asking? God deserves our trust. He deserves to be the one we depend on. And we do have real needs, legitimate. There are times when life is breaking us. There are things people go through that are unbearable. You know about grief. Many of you know about grief. You know about not having hope. You know about dead ends. You know about dryness. You know about fear and dread. You know what it is to have a need you just cannot fix. I hope you know about a Father who loves you. I hope you remember things that He's done already. Pretty much any group you're ever in, every person you're looking at could be dead. Right? That car wreck, falling out of that tree, that smart aleck thing you said to a guy twice your size when you were 9 years old, sickness. We all could be dead, but here we are. God has been good to us. Our hearts have been broken. Our plans have been shattered. We're often confused. But we have a Father. He deserves our trust. He deserves our trust. He's earned it. He might be the only one we have, but He's enough. So they're griping to Moses, and he's praying, God, I don't know what to do. And he says, take that tree, cut it down, throw it in the water. So he did. And that tree is a symbol in many people's minds of the cross of Jesus, that wood. That's the answer. That's the answer to the devastating consequences of our sin, the destruction we've unleashed with our willfulness, our pride, our arrogance, and our self-centeredness. We need the tree. We need the cross. We need forgiveness. And when God could have said anything, He could have said, you know, throw your brother in. He could have said, you know, throw a rock, anything. It didn't matter. Whatever God said to do, if you do it, it's going to be okay somehow. And so he did what God said, and the water was fine. The people got their drink. And the crazy thing is they were just a short distance from another oasis that had 12 springs of water, one for each tribe. It's called Elim, and it was just around the bend. They had no idea how close they were. Anyway, but God took care of them. He deserves our trust. He delivered them from slavery and from bondage, and now He was delivering them from bondage to their self-centered wills. He took them through the discipline of a detour. He took them through the dilemma of what looked like a dead end. He took them through the distress of dry throats. And each time He taught them again and a little more, you can trust me. I love that hymn that has these words, they who trust Him wholly find Him wholly true. Like a mighty, no, what is it? Something river. Yeah, it's a good song. My friend had a birthday this week. I don't see him much, but I did his wedding, and I led him to the Lord, and we've been in touch, and he's just been fun to watch grow and serve God for 12 years or so. And I called him on his birthday, and I said, how are you? He said, grateful. I said, okay, there's a story, huh? He said, yeah. I was riding to work on my motorcycle, and I was on Snelling Avenue. He was between Roseville and the State Fairgrounds on Snelling Avenue. It's downtown. It's city. It's the suburbs. There's houses. There's stores. It's in town. And a deer ran onto the road, smack into him. He said, I looked after, and there was a coyote standing there. A coyote was chasing a deer in town. And the timing was perfect for that thing to smack him on his bike. He said, "Dale, I've known three other bikers who hit deer. Two of them are dead. The other one is permanently damaged, injured." He said, "I walked away." He said, "I didn't go off the road. I didn't veer into traffic. I didn't even fall over." He said, "I'm grateful." God has ways of just reminding us we have a lot to be grateful for. How many things didn't happen in your life that you can't even be aware of? I mean, how many times has this friend of mine rides his bike all over? He goes out west, up in the mountains, he's all over, out to Sturgis. How many other deer could have ran into him? How many of them were within 100 yards of him? And just if he'd have left a minute later or sooner, you know what I'm saying? How many things have you not had happen? Only God knows. But there have been some, you can be sure of it, because of who He is. He's good. He's very good. Once in a while, He lets it get close enough so we realize He's taking care of us. Sometimes He lets things hurt us so we realize who heals us. He's a good, good Father. Everything He does, everything He allows, everything that reaches us has an intended purpose. Our problems have a purpose. They are to draw us to Him. They are to deepen our understanding. They are to put roots to our faith. They are to nurture our souls. They are to help us know a good, good Father better than we have before. Whatever comes our way this week, may we let it draw us closer to despair, closer to Him. He's worth knowing, isn't He? Whatever it takes to know Him better is worth it. That's big talk for a guy who's feeling pretty healthy, whose bills are paid at the moment. He's got a great wife. Big talk. Sometimes it's not as easy to say it because it hurts. I know that. I know that too. But when you get through the Red Sea, you're always glad you were there. You're always glad it happened. You wouldn't take it back. So if things are going good for you this week, good. Enjoy it. Love it. Don't be afraid of what might change. Just love it and thank God for it, because He's got the grace to keep you going. And if it starts to hurt, you're not done. Don't camp out there. If you're doubting, don't camp out there. Just say, "Okay, God, what comes next?" He's worth knowing, and He will show Himself. We're going to sing one more time. I think this one will be fun. I hope you're ready to sing. Here we go. group of kids were invited to write a letter to God.